The Gardener's Question Time and Friday Night is Music Night.
All right, I'll just sit through Roscoe's Round Table, don't I? But I draw the line at David Diddy Hamilton. Why does she never all finish, Nick?
Well, screws think it makes his work harder. They're piping Tony Blackburn into the kitchens now.
Oh, they're only doing that because they believe we're in prison to be punished.
No, I wanted to hear that. Let's have this special request slot.
Huh?
Hello, Young Lover's Corner.
Oh, yeah.
And I sent a request in life for Denise.
Denise?
My fiancée.
Oh, that Denise, yeah, yeah.
I wanted to express my feelings of undying love and devotion. Everlasting Love was the record I asked for.
Should have asked for my ding-a-ling, shouldn't you?
Been listening all week and it ain't been on yet. It's not fair. You'd think my needs would be greater than some almond sorters in Dundee.
Here I am, huh? Did you write on prison notepaper?
Yeah, if you remember rightly, I gave you my last sheet of Basil and Bond.
Well, that's it, isn't it?
Why? The bias against prisoners?
No, no, not officially, no, but I can't recall of ever hearing a prisoner's request on the air, can you? I mean, forces, yes, aircraft carriers, ACAC batteries and all that, but never from no one from no nick, no.
Well, that's terrible. We have a bad enough time in here without having our request denied. That's discrimination, that is. And 5.5 big stamps sort of stuff.
Yeah. Well, you can see from their point of view, can't you? I mean, the public who pay their license faithful every year. I mean, they're bound to take offence, aren't they, eh? I mean, you're sitting around there Sunday lunchtime with your beloved family favourites. Sonny to read out a postcard with a Parker's postmark. And Tommy Mad Dog Hollister, please, a Claire de Lune.
Claire de Lune?
Oh, yes, that's French, Mr. Mackay. French for the by the light of the silver moon.
Thought for a moment, Fletcher, you were having a cultural conversation.
Hey, perhaps you can help us with the ruling, Mr. Mackay.
Ruling, Gubba?
Yeah, Miss Lonely Loin's here. Oh, love, Lorne Lenny. He wants to know whether the BBC ever played Prisoner's Request.
No. Oh, no. The answer for that is no. On the grounds that it could cause embarrassment.
Embarrassment?
To the prisoners' families. The families might have excused his absence by telling the neighbours that the felon in question was abroad, or working on a North Sea oil rig.
Oh, I see.
No doubt your wife, Fletcher, has told your friends that you're on a 5-year safari.
No, she just tells them I'm doing missionary work in Scotland.
No, but the practice was also open to abuse. You see, there was nothing to stop prisoners sending messages in code across our airwaves.
Oh, yeah, that's a point, yeah. Yeah, that is a point, isn't it, eh? Some heartwarming Christmas message to some old lag, or from some old lag, rather, to his wife and family, his little tiny Tim, eh? Can we have Harry Seacombe singing The Impossible Dream? Translated, what he really meant was, can Nobby be round the back of Ewing with a ladder on Boxing Day? And I'm inspired.
That's a good idea, that.
Yeah. It's an abuse of privilege, Hubba, which is why I'm here.
Oh, well, it's a sociable.
Six soft toilet rolls have disappeared from the governor's closet. The governor's personal water closet.
Oh, dear. Would you, Adam and Eve, whatever next?
Knowing you, Fletcher, probably the seat.
Don't look at me, sir.
Nor me. It's writing paper, I'm sure, sir.
Well, that's not right. We've had to give the governor's standard prison issue tissue.
That's rough.
Rough, yeah. I'll say it. That'll wipe the smile off his face.
Fortune has given you two privileged positions in this prison. You should do well not to jeopardise them by any infraction of the rules. I'll say no more.
Thank you, Mr. Mackay.
Yeah, thanks for the advice.
Yeah, to which we should pay greatly. Now, nap off. Sorry.
He's always picking on us, isn't he?
Of course he is. It's his devious, suspicious mind, isn't it? The nosy nook. Care for a glass of toilet roll?
I need a cup of
I did have six.
Where's the other five?
I traded them, didn't I?
Two.
Well, there's still a few felons in this nick who've got a bit of refinement, you know. The bottom landing, cell at the end, couple of embezzlers in there. There's Mr. Banyard, the unfrocked dentist. There's a lot of white-collared felons in here who jump at this sort of stuff, you know what I mean?
What'd you get?
Eh? Well, I'm owed, didn't I? I'm owed. A lot of nice middle-class merchandise. I'm promised a cricket sweater, a pair of ice puppies, and a box of after-dinner mints.
Hey, well, share and share alike.
Yeah. What?
That's the rule of the house, isn't it?
Share my toilet roll.
Well, it's only fair.
Share my toilet roll, Gobba.
It's only fair. Look at all these socks I've darned.
Yeah, all right. Mind how you go. Hello, Ingrid, love. Hello. Mm.
Hey, Fletcher.
Yeah?
This is my mum. This is Godmother.
Pleased to meet you, Mr. Fletcher.
Fletcher's my message, Gobba. Got a fine lad here. This is my oldest, Ingrid.
Hello.
Sit down, Fletcher. And you, Papa. This isn't a royal garden party, you know.
Who's that?
Mr. Mackay, that is. Jonas Celtic Nook.
Mr. Bob. Hey.
Oh, it's Gobba. Lenny Gobba. He's my temporary cellmate. He comes from Birmingham, but he has got an O-level in geography.
Oh.
Well, you need one to find your way around Birmingham, don't you? They've all gone up there. How's your mother?
Oh, she's fine, Dad. She sends a laugh and everything.
Oh, good. How's your sister?
Oh, Marion's fine. Yeah, she got a new job.
Can't she ever keep a job for more than 3 weeks?
It's the bosses she has trouble with. They molest her, she alleges.
Yeah. That's her, and she flaunts herself, don't she, eh? Skirts right up to expectations. Where's she now, then?
Timothy White.
Oh, she'll be all right there. One molester there. They're all qualified pharmacists, aren't they?
Her flat fell through.
What flat was that?
Well, the one behind Olympia, what she shared with six other people.
Six? Fell through to the flat beneath us, didn't it?
No, the rent went up. No, she's only getting paid ten.
Oh. How's young Raymond?
Oh, he's fine. You know, he won the mile in his school sports.
Did he? Wish I had him on a beer now.
And he came singing the high jump, and he's swimming for the school, and he's the stage manager in the school play.
Is he? Yeah, why isn't he in it then? He played Yum Yum in Macaulay last, didn't he?
Well, his voice is gone.
Oh.
Well, he's on 30 a day.
He's what? He's only 14. 30 a day? That's terrible. That's a dreadful waste of money, that is.
But the side of the coupon stays.
Oh, well,
he wants to get an aqualung.
He'll need one if he goes on 30 a day.
He wants to go skin diving in St. Ives.
I know, all his achievements are extracurricular, ain't they? Don't he fancy anything inside a classroom?
Mostly the ghouls, babe.
Dear, you tell him for me to curb his appetites. I don't want him getting no girl into trouble.
Well, if you hadn't, I wouldn't be here.
No, we don't want any coarse remarks of that nature, thank you. I can't believe my ears when I hear you kids today. I thought,
there's nothing wrong, Dan. I mean, you and Mum have proved that your love wasn't just a passing infatuation. Silver wedding.
Nevertheless, I don't want my adolescent love life held up as a yardstick to young Raymond. He's only 14. When what happened to your mother and me, we were mature, responsible 16-year-olds. In Ivor Cemetery, what? But you see, we had something behind us. The tomb of Karl Marx. No, but your mum had a nice, steady job in the hardware department of damages, and I have a plastering diploma from Vorstal. You speak of Margaret Cemetery, how's your lover?
Oh, Lee said.
Is this still like Eddie Risley? I've warned you about him, haven't I, by the way? He's a crook, he's Eddie Risley.
He's straight bad. It's just that he's a tough businessman.
Yeah.
It's unfair what people keep saying about him. They tell you it's so his own mother.
I heard that on very good authority.
Who's
that? Two blokes who bought his mother.
Oh, it's no good talking to you about Eddie. You've got a blind spot about him.
So are you, girl, so are you. He's giving you a bad time, isn't he?
I just don't know where I am with him.
You don't know off-pick him, don't you, eh? Eh? You're a bonny girl, you've got a lovely nature, you could have anyone you want, you could. And also, you're not getting any younger. 24. Has to be said, 24.
That's not old.
Is this for a teenager? And a spinster.
Oh, that things have changed since your day. Girls want to be... Well, they don't want to be tied down so quick. I think there's alternatives to marriage.
Not in Muswell Hill, they don't. Nothing's changed in Muswell Hill.
Well, between the Odeon.
Yeah, I'm talking about standards. Moral standards. I mean, what do all these social commentators know, eh? They don't know nothing about the real world. They all live within a stone's throw of each other in Northwest One, don't they? Never been further north than Hampstead or further south than Sloane Square. In the real world, Birmingham, Bristol, Muswell Hill, fundamentally, are you wearing a bra or not?
I don't need to, Dad.
What do you mean you don't need to?
I haven't done for ages, my breasts are firm and pliant.
Easy, Ned. This isn't Saint-Tropez, you know, it's slave bleeding prison in here. There's 600 men in here go berserk at the sight of a bit of shin. Never mind unfair knockers. Well, I'm sorry, my girl, but it has to be said, you are very naive in certain ways. You're very naive about the effect that your body can have on a shackled male.
Dad, you are very naive in certain ways. I shouldn't think anyone's even noticed.
Copper. Copper. Copper.
What?
You awake?
What's the matter?
You got any snout?
No, I haven't. Would you believe it? I haven't.
Yeah, I believe it, you inconsiderate nerd.
I thought you'd given up.
I felt like starting again. Mind you, Ed.
You mum bought me some Maltesers.
No, thanks.
That's the parking cake.
No, thanks. If you haven't got no snout, napples back this week.
Oh, yeah. Thanks very much.
But temper old scrope.
What's the matter with you, anyway?
I've got things on my mind, haven't I?
Like what?
My business.
Oh, come on, Fletcher. You might as well talk it out and wake me up now.
I just get a bit depressed at times, that's all. Seeing it stir.
That's not like you, Fletcher.
My father's place at home, ain't it, with his kids, giving him affection. Parental guidance. I've got three, you know.
Yeah, I know.
14, 19 and 24.
Quite a gap between each.
Circumstances dictated that.
How?
Well, I had to keep going in prison for 5 years, didn't I? We're too young, this world. Teens is a terrible age anyway, innit? Expect trouble in the teens, don't you? But do you think my Ingrid would have learned a few lessons by now, wouldn't you?
Seemed a nice girl to me. She had lovely...
I know what she had lovely, thank you. So, father, you're talking to, be very careful, Gobber.
Eyes. I was going to say eyes. Lovely eyes.
Yeah.
Big and blue.
Oh, yeah.
And a nice smile, which seems to indicate a warm and generous nature.
Yes, yes, true, true. Well, that's all right, then.
I pledge. Yeah. I don't mind me saying this, like, but, well, I couldn't help overhearing a teeny bit of what you were saying, like. Well, most of us did.
Oh, yeah.
Well, he don't seem good enough for this Eddie Risley, if you ask me.
No, he's not. He said he works in a motor trade. You know what he does? Forges his car logbooks. Not that she'd believe it.
Well, how can you be sure?
I bought two of him. They weren't much cop either. He spelled citron with an S.
Well, that's somebody too much. He'll probably get rumbled sooner or later, and that'll give her time to find someone new. And I should think young Marion's just awakening to the possibility of her sex, and will settle down now, Timothy Wides. And I shouldn't worry about young Raymond either, because I was on 30 when I was 14. Oh, well, congratulations on your silver wedding.
Did you earwig all my conversation, Gobba? Eh? Why didn't you talk to your poor old mother? It's a long schlep from Birmingham, you know.
She doesn't have much to say, does Mum? She's a canny old soul, but she only usually gives me a catalogue of family ailments.
No news of the lovely Denise, then?
Nah, she don't talk about Denise on account she don't approve of her.
Huh? Why not?
Well, she uses green nail varnish and don't wear a bra.
Sounds like her and my daughter Ingrid have got a lot in common.
Your Ingrid's got nice knockers.
Fletcher, could I have a word?
Plain draft, huh?
Well, it is rather important. I wouldn't ask otherwise.
Ooh, so is this important, isn't it? I'll have to abandon the same. All right, Cedric? Pull it through, right? Off it.
I'm sorry to disturb you in association, huh?
That's all right, it's only drafting it.
Well, that's not your game as a rule, is it?
No, there's not much else to do at the moment. Only news on the telly now. Someone's trolling a ping pong ball, isn't it?
Oh, dear. I'm sorry. It's a mess, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, I wanted a quiet word.
I'm all ears.
Do you know where Gobber is?
Gobber? At the moment, he'll be doing one of his box seating classes. Security woodwork.
No, he's up in front of the governor.
See? The lad, what's he done?
Oh, he's attacked another prisoner. That worked in the kitchen. He attacked Jackdaw with a soup ladle.
I don't believe it.
Well, I'm sure it was a severe and unprovoked attack, the officer said.
I can't believe it. I mean, I know Jackdaw gets on everybody's nerves, but I mean, Lenny, he's a passive sort of boy. I mean, he wouldn't hurt a fly.
Now, that's why I've come to see you, sir. I thought you might be able to throw some light on the matter.
Well, I don't know. Seemed his usual self this morning. Lunchtime, he was quite cheerful. Mind you, one of your colleagues, Mr. Pringle, did step on a bit of orange peel and sit down the stairs and hurt his back. So he was all quite cheerful, no?
Fletcher, really, you must be serious. Godber is in trouble. It's so irrational, you see. No, I like that lad, you know. I think he shows a lot of promise.
It's the system, isn't it, eh? It's the system. It's the prison, isn't it, eh? Turning an affable young lad like that into a violent criminal. I mean, you're sitting on a volcano in here, you know. A volcano which could at any time erupt into an explosion of violence and mayhem.
Oh, Fletcher, you've got your finger on the pulse, you know. How can we avert this?
Well, there is one thing you could do to postpone the inevitable Holocaust.
Yeah, well, what?
You could indent for another pink bumble. Well then what? I heard.
Heard what?
Heard you hit Jackdaw with a ladle.
Heard right then, didn't you?
Must have had your reasons.
I did.
So ain't you going in the cooler then?
No, I'm not.
Well, you're a lucky lad, ain't you?
Lucky, am I?
Yeah. Assault, innit? Ladling a fellow prisoner. Automatic cooler offence, ladling.
I got a severe reprimand, lost the privileges, would have got the cooler, but the governor accepted in mitigating circumstances.
Mitigating circumstances? You must have. Look, you don't have to tell me. You don't have to tell me what drove a normal, affable lad to such a pitch where he launches into a fellow prisoner with a deadly weapon, to wit, one ladle.
I won't then. I'd rather not.
Oh, I see. I see. It hasn't occurred to you that your hitherto blameless record is doing no small part to yours truly. I mean, the guy showed you the ropes. Helped you get by. Kept you on the rails. Loaned you his soft toilet paper.
I'm not ungrateful. Every time I go to the bottom, I'm not ungrateful.
Look, Bobber. Having eavesdropped into very many aspects of my private life, don't you think it's about time I knew something about yours?
So I've got some news which upset me. Jackdaw thought it was a joke, kept checking the mic. So I hit him and the balance of my mind was disturbed.
News?
Yeah.
What news? The Dear John letter, is it?
Yeah, any market, it's dear Lenny.
Naturally. Yours, but no longer forever, Denise, eh?
That's right.
So it's the demise of Denise, is it?
That's not funny, Fletcher.
Was I making a joke? No, what I call a joke, no. Look, don't you think I've seen this happen hundreds of times, eh? It's only natural, son. Not to say inevitable, but I mean, at least she was honest enough to write you a letter, because they're all at it like knives when we're in here, you know?
Yeah, but it come right out of the blue, did this. There's no interview a fortnight ago in her last letter. My main concern then was whether we should have a butchery guard or a canary.
In your future life today, Amy?
Yeah.
One decision you won't have to make?
So it's not.
Look, son, I know it's only academic now, but speaking personally, from personal experience, I would say that, always, by and large, I would, plump for a budgerigar.
Why?
A bit more friendly. And canaries is very prone to drafts, you know. I think it's the angle of their tail. See, I speak from experience, because we had a canary once. Surly little bleeder, wasn't it?
Well, as you say, Flesh, the question's now academic, isn't it?
Yeah, he's dead, yeah. So Denise has had, she's been, someone's, There's another man, isn't it? You know him?
His name's Kenneth. He's in the Merchant Navy, third engineer. Qualified. So there's no contest, is there?
I see. Jack's the lad, is it, eh? Jolly Jack Tar, a sailor with a navy blue eyes, is it? And all the gold brain. Sun shines out of his porthole, I know. Don't way, Sonny Chapri, son. Only Chapri, once he goes to sea, say to beware then, eh? You'll be out there with Denise. He'll be stuck right at the Persian Gulf, eh? Then you can just assume your rightful position with Denise, can't you, eh? In her affection days, on it. Take from me, son, a temporary setback.
I don't think so, thanks.
No sweat at all.
She's married him.
Said what?
Last Saturday, his medic registry office. She thought it my right to know.
Married him.
Apparently kept fine for him. And the cross keys did him proud, patty and ham salad.
Well, I'm appalled. I don't know what to say. Patty and ham salad.
Mum's definitely coming up next month, Dad. She wouldn't come today only the doctor expressly forbade it. He said she'd be a fool to herself.
Are you serious, are you?
No, just something going round, he says.
Right.
Marrying, imp with Jeffy White's no longer.
And she? Oh, dispensed with her services, haven't
I? It wasn't molestation this time. She's got a better job. She's selling shirts. She shows them around the offices.
Oh, makes a change from showing her knickers around the offices, isn't
it? And she's had another flat in Maidvale, what she's sharing with the nurses.
Yeah.
And what you'll be most glad to hear is me and Eddie split up.
Have you? Oh, not before time, girl. Now, that's a great relief to us all, that is.
Yeah, we was very worried about that, yeah.
Your mind, Godba. Would you get on with your own visit, please? I'm sorry, Mrs. Godba, I have to warn this boy about this before. Haven't you got any news from the home front, dear?
Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Fletcher, but I can't think of anything to say, you know. It's like visiting people in hospital.
Yeah, well, force yourself, will you, love, force
yourself. Here.
He does bird impressions.
You all know the procedure. Conversation will be confined to the relative or friend opposite the prisoner in question. The no fratricide side here.
That's what I keep telling you, Mr. McKay. So if you will excuse us, Godba.
Yeah, sorry, Fletch. Sorry, miss.
It's all right.
So, you've given Eddie the big ear, have you? That's great. Good. Now, you stick to what your father tells you in future, all right?
I do that. Did you notice how much more discreet I am today?
What do you mean?
Well, last time I was here, I obviously embarrassed you in front of all your friends. But this time I ain't giving you no calls, have I?
And sure, I'll don't get you, girl.
But look, I'm wearing a bra.
Look at that. The ping pong ball, isn't it? Ping pong ball, eh? Who's that?
We don't play.
I don't play, no. But some of you nerds in here, though, don't you, eh?